Hello and welcome to Nirmalbang, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here all Darya. With the coronavirus pandemic throwing challenges on all fronts, including health, economy, and livelihood, among others, financial security and capital protection have actually emerged as the top priority for individuals in current times. Having spent almost 25 years in the capital markets and managed funds across equity, fixed income, real estate for local as well as global investors, we have Dilesh Shah, MD Kotak Asset Management and Chairman Amfi, joining in. In fact, as we all know in his previous assignments, Nilesh has held leadership roles with Axis Capital, ICICI Prudential, Asset Management, Franklin Templeton, ICICI Securities. I mean, the list goes on. Nilesh, overall, if you know, the first question I want to ask you is, as a hobby, reading, educating investors on financial planning is something that holds the crux for you. You've also co-authored a book on financial planning called A Direct Take. Let us get your direct take today first. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Kiran. It's my pleasure to be talking to investors. And clearly, this is the most unprecedented crisis we have seen in our lifetime. I have seen medical crisis like plague in Surat way back in 90s. I have gone through financial crisis like Asian crisis, subprime crisis, taper tantrum. But we have never seen a perfect storm like what we are witnessing today. Medical crisis shutting down economic activity shut down, resulting into financial crisis. Today, our economy is battling economic crisis, financial crisis, and medical crisis all together. It's almost replica of a movie called Perfect Storm, where George Clooney took his fishing trawler to a spot where multiple storms were raging together.
Absolutely. A well-made point, Nilesh, over here. Nilesh, Big Banyan Tree, giant of Dalal Street, black sheep of your family, you know, a lot of names that have been coined for you. In fact, some of them you call yourself as well. Which is your favorite that you've heard so far?
So one, Hiral, when I say black sheep of my family, it's because as Gujaratis, we are supposed to do business, right? Not supposed to do a job. I'm one of that rare person in my extended family who is surviving by working. The only moniker which works for me is student of the market. There are many people who say we are gurus of the market, we are giants of the Dalal Street. Well, that's all bullshit. We are all students of the market. The day we have ego, we'll crash.
Correct. So if you have to look at coming generations, Dilesh, what would you want to be called as, you know, I mean, you already said that we're all students of the market, but every time someone builds an identity over time, so probably for the next 2 to 3 generations, what would you want to be called?
So, you know, India got independence because millions of people contributed to it. None of them got recognition like Mahatma Gandhi or Sardar Patel or Jawaharlal Nehru or Subhash Chandra Bose. It's the effort of many squirrels which helped build Ram Setu connecting to Lanka.
Correct.
I would like to be known as that squirrel who contributed to India's economic independence. I don't have the stature to be bigger than squirrel, but in my limited ability, whatever stone I can carry, I want to carry so that I can be contributor to maintaining India's economic independence. When I started my career in stock market, FPIs were owning 0% of Indian equity.
Right.
There were companies in which multinational companies were owning some equity, but their percentage would have been probably less than 5 or 6%. Today, FPIs own about 21% of India's equity. And FDI, if we include, that will be another 10, 11%.
Right.
Effectively, retail investors through insurance companies, mutual funds, and direct ownership own less in India Inc. than foreign portfolio investors. When our companies will declare good results, celebrations will be in New York, Tokyo, Singapore, London, but not in Surat, Jaipur, Bhagalpur, Patna, Lucknow. We may think some of the best known Indian companies are our companies. Of course, they are run by Indians.
Correct.
But the hard work of those Indians will be celebrated by foreigners because they own majority of that stake. I would like to work as a squirrel of Ramayana in ensuring this Indian company's economic ownership remains with India. And when Indians do hard work and create wealth, it is distributed among Indians rather than foreigners.
That's a very well-made point. And Nilesh, I think we've always heard you give anecdotes from mythological books. You've always compared, you know, markets with regards to cricketers, all of this. And I think that's something which everyone actually relates to. And you have been one of the few fund managers who believe that, you know, fund management is more about, you know, common sense and not always about fancy degrees and qualifications. You've always said that you've always been responsible to your investors. In these unprecedented times, Nilesh, what would your advice be to these investors?
So, to investor, my advice will be, one, have a financial plan. If you step out of your home without recognizing where you want to go, how will you reach your destination? Second, once you have a financial plan, sit with a mutual fund distributor or financial advisor and choke out how to achieve that financial goal, how to achieve closure to that financial plan. Third, in the journey, there will be upheavals, there will be volatility, but don't get deterred by the volatility. Stick with your financial plan with the help of your trusted advisor and remain invested over the volatility, over the upheavals to achieve your financial independence. There are only three guru mantras for financial independence. One is long-term investment. There is a saying in Gujarati which says that utavare amba na pake. You can't grow mango tree in less than 12 years. If you don't go and complain to God that why do I have to wait for mango for 12 years, then please respect that in stock market also you'll have to invest on a longer term basis to make money. Second is regular investment. I haven't seen any person who takes 365 days medicine of blood pressure or cholesterol to cure himself. Mm. They strictly follow one tablet a day regime. The same thing applies for financial health. You can't be putting money in lump sum to achieve your financial independence. That happens once in a blue moon, not every day. And third, and the most important, is disciplined asset allocation. Like you create a thali of dal, roti, chawal, sabji, soup, dessert, salad, which gives you taste, which gives you nourishment, which makes you physically healthy. Same way you build a portfolio across real estate, debt, equity, commodities, and offshore assets to build financial health. So be a long-term investor, be a regular investor, be a disciplined asset allocator. And this three matters, these three guru mantras will take care of your financial health.
A very well, you know, made point, Nilesh, over here. And especially with regards to the food thali that you mentioned, I think, you know, most investors, the mistake that they make is probably select the salad, select the rice, miss the dal or miss the sabzi. And that's where they need to focus on, right?
Absolutely. Many investors try to look at past return and invest. Mm. Now, experience has taught us that looking at the rear view mirror and driving the car does not necessarily work. The rear view mirror might show a fantastic road, but if front view is showing that there is a big hole in the road, mm-hmm. you need to be careful. So don't look at past performance and invest. Try to assess future potential and invest. You will go wrong. You could go wrong. But that doesn't matter. It's still important to drive looking at front view mirror rather than rear view mirror.
Absolutely. I mean, the front view mirror is something which is absolutely necessary from here on. Nilesh, last 60 days, all of us have been working from home right now. How has your experience been? Because I don't think so. Anyone in the last couple of generations have seen these kind of times where they've been locked down. There has been no movement. People have started working from home as well. How would you distinguish this experience of yours?
So one, I have to thank God that I still have a job and I am able to execute my job sitting in the comfort of home. I'm extremely thankful to God for giving me that opportunity. Second, I owe it to my investors to ensure that their decision-making is not driven by panic, by fake news, by WhatsApp research. Their decision should be driven by data.
Okay.
Now, we have seen market correcting sharply in the month of March and April. Clearly, SIP returns turned negative. And we have to communicate with our investors that, look, yes, today at the end of April, your SIP returns are looking negative. For 1 year, 3 year, for 5 year, it's marginally positive, but much lower than bank fixed deposits. But still stay invested and keep on buying, because when markets will improve, your SIP returns will look far better. There were investors who had invested money for last 3 years in small and mid-cap fund, and they were not seeing any return whatsoever. It was important to engage with them to ensure that they stay invested.
Right.
And their notional loss is not converted into real loss. In the April, we also struggled on the debt side. There was isolated incidents by Franklin Templeton for winding down of their six schemes. That created panic among investors and people rushed into redeem. We had to engage them as Kotak Mutual Fund, as Association of Mutual Fund in India. Fortunately, people could look through the narrative being created and we were able to meet redemptions and satisfy every single investor without resorting to borrowing. Our portfolio quality and portfolio liquidity ensured that even unexpected redemptions were met in normal business situation. But it was important to connect with investors and make them stay invested. Many people thought we were doing this for our AUM and our fees.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it was for actually their benefit. All those investors who redeemed during the panic of credit risk fund lost some amount of their return. Over last 1 month plus, credit risk funds have delivered almost 3% return as spreads have contracted.
Right.
And selling by mutual fund has come to an end as investors stop withdrawing money from credit risk fund. Now, our objective is that notional loss of an investor does not get converted into real loss.
Right.
If you stay invested, whatever loss you are seeing on your debt and equity portfolio will remain notional. As markets recover, these things will turn into positive. But if people redeem and go away, they will go with bitter experience. Then they will need convictions to come back, and it may take a long period of time. So our objective is to ensure that our investors' notional loss is not converted into real loss. We give them data so that they can take decisions. I don't want them to trust me blindly, but please don't take decisions based on WhatsApp messages and fake news. Try to take decision based on what you see. At least in mutual fund industry, we are the most transparent industry in India today, or probably in the world. We disclose entire of our portfolio at the end of the month. Look at the portfolios and then take a call whether your money is worth investing or not.
Absolutely. I mean, retail investors need to have that patience as well, because sometimes what happens is there is an unfortunate isolated event, like as you mentioned about Franklin as well. What happens is the immediate reaction that we see from retail investors also is, okay, something's gone wrong. Something wrong has been done by the fund manager. Or probably if there is probably even a wrong decision that has been taken on a particular stock, for example, immediately you start hearing a lot of chatter. I think that is something in terms of the trust factor that needs to change between the investors and the fund managers. Because the moment you have your trust on the fund manager, you have to somewhere keep it up to him as to, yes, you know, I mean, you can't, I wouldn't say you have to say that the fund manager is my God. But you have to have that trust factor in your fund managers as well, because that's when you will see success from here on. But Nilesh, with the lockdown, you know, we've always spoken about Nilesha being a workaholic. Somewhere you've always said that, yes, I do find my time to find my work-life balance. But now that you've been, you know, working from home, do you think that equation has improved further with regards to spending time with family? How do you do that?
So let me first cover the one portion about fund management. And I'll give you my own personal experience. Mm-hmm. So in April 2019, we had 6 FMPs maturing. Mm-hmm. And against 100 rupee on maturity value, which we had to pay, we had to withheld about 10% of money, which we had invested in SL Group debentures. Mm-hmm. There were thousands of investors in that. When we announced it, it became headline. The first headline was as if we are not returning any money. Then we corrected that, saying that, look, out of 190 I am returning, it's only 10 which I am withholding. Mm-hmm. Second, then the headline became, oh, you are now working for promoters. You have forgotten your duty to unit holders. You should be dumping shares and paying back investors. Now, people who were making this noise were expecting us to sell the shares in market at whatever price. And if we would have done that, my guess is that we would have probably recovered 20 or 30% of money, and 70 or 80% would have lost. Everyone who was making noise about us to sell those shares were not investors in our FMP.
Correct.
They were not even investors in our fund. In fact, they had no relationship or no interest in what we do with our FMP. When there was too much of noise, and this did impact us, I did an analysis of who the people who are making noises, and I found that none of them are my investors. We reached out to thousands of investors on phone calls, on emails, on group conference calls, on a variety of medium via distributors. At least half of the investors said that, Nilesh bhai, we have seen you over 25 years and we believe what you are doing is in our interest. You don't have to bother to call us.
Correct.
It was such a reassuring message. Where I still remember one gentleman in Ghatkopar firing the relationship manager. You told me Nilesh bhai is going to call for a discussion on market and he's apologizing for this withholding of money. I have full trust in him. I don't want to talk about it. I'm sure whatever he will do will be right for me. When this kind of response has come, it gives us energy to fight all those naysayers. Half of the investors were obviously worried, saying that, what have you done? I had my FMP money. You are not giving me money. We explained them that, look, if I go and sell shares in the market, I'll probably recover 20-30%. But if you give me 6 months, I'll be able to recover probably 100%. They immediately asked that, are you guaranteeing it? I said, no, I'm not guaranteeing it. All I'm guaranteeing is that I'll make all the effort. Beyond effort, I'm not guaranteeing any money. They were annoyed, but they didn't have much choice. So they gave us the time. In 6 months' time frame, we worked and repaid money with accrued interest. Today, 100% of our investors believe that what we did was right. Now, investors are happy. All those naysayers who wanted us to sell shares at a huge discount and cause loss to our investors haven't even acknowledged that we have repaid money to the investors as promised. When we didn't pay, that became headline. When we paid, it didn't even appear in their radar. Now, look at from my point of view. If I had sold those debentures in the market at any price and repaid money causing loss to the investors, I will be doing what was as per regulation and it would not have involved any repercussion. Yeah. We did what we thought was morally right, and today I am facing cases in my individual capacity as well as my firm. Investors have got their money back. All those critics are now quiet, but I am still fighting my case and I don't know what will happen over there. By taking personal risk, we have done what is right for unit holders. why have we done this? It's only for those investors who told me that Nilesh bhai, whatever you will do will be right for us, and we have that confidence. I'm working for those unit holders. This is why you need to give confidence to the fund managers. We are all operating under constraints of market.
Absolutely.
In the debt market, there is hardly any liquidity, yet year after year, day after day, we have provided daily redemptions to millions of investors. What is not possible in capital market, we have delivered through portfolio structuring, through portfolio management. Obviously, there are ups and downs. And I'm sure what happened in Franklin Templeton is an isolated event. Rest of the mutual funds have continued their activity in normal course. And if there is no panic reaction, I'm sure business will continue normally.
Absolutely, Nilesh. Very well pointed out. And I think your example that you've cited right now as well, that's something which everyone as an investor needs to follow as well, at least in terms of having the trust, giving the confidence to the fund manager as well. And in any aspect of investments that you're looking at. So with all of this on the fund side, Nilesh, we were again talking about with regards to the work-life balance, with how you've been spending time with family, probably your travel hours have reduced. So I think that's the extra time that you would be getting, you know, on that front as well. How is that equation working right now?
So when there is crisis, you have to be at the front. A general can't be leading from the back. And 2020 crisis is almost similar to 2008. On equity, there were investor concerns. We had to operate on digital side without going to office. There were a host of rules and regulations to comply with.
Right.
We had debt crisis as well in between. And even today, we have to fight fake news which are being circulated on WhatsApp. There was about 15 days back, a WhatsApp circulated by some people about the FMPs, which we had withheld in April 19 and paid back in September 19. But it was being recirculated in a manner to suggest that we are going to follow Templeton way in withholding money. Now, it's an absolute fake news, but again, it put us on alert and we had to start replying to people even on a Sunday. Now, in times of crisis, it's difficult to maintain work-life balance even if you're operating from home. It's important for us to protect our unit holders' interest. It's important for us to ensure that they get all the data to take decisions. I don't want any of my unit holders to trust me. I respect that trust a lot, but I still want them to take decision based on data. I don't want them to trust me blindly. I will do everything possible to honor that trust, but I still want them to take decisions based on data. Now, fortunately, I have a family which understands my compulsions, which allows me the freedom to do my work. And thanks to the lockdown and a lot of easing down of panic in last 45 days, there is some amount of time to be spent with family. Travel time has reduced. Your working hours have become flexible. People are cooperative enough to, you know, talk at 8 o'clock in the morning also and 12 o'clock in the night. We service offshore customers also, so our day doesn't end at India standard time. We also contribute a lot on many other aspects, including policy making. There are challenges for the industry where we have to work together. So there is enough work, but fortunately I have a family which allows me the space to carry on my work.
Absolutely. So Nilesh, you have two daughters. So is it the woman power who are the fund managers at home, or you continue to remain the fund manager at home?
Both my daughters as well as my wife are into non-financial profession. My wife is a doctor from IIT, and she is doing a wonderful work right now with Isha Foundation in providing help to the needy people. She's working actually harder than me because she's managing that part as well as home. I only manage office side and contribute much lesser to the home side. My two daughters, one is pursuing medical profession, other is in US pursuing biology. So all three of them have limited interest in finance, and financial decisions are given to me. However, I will request all women participants over here to take active interest in financial decision making. I'll share a very simple incident which one of my friend had. Today, he's no more, but I will still share the incidents. He and his wife, decades ago, had gone for a holiday abroad. When they came back, the husband came home with a very sad face and said, "This holiday costed us a lot." Wife asked, "Why are you feeling so sad after such a great holiday?" And he said, "You know, when we were abroad, our office people went and booked a flat in a particular property at 2,700 rupees square feet. I also wanted to book flat over there, but now it's available at 3,000. I have lost 10% of money. If we had not taken holiday, we would have got the property at 2,700. The wife asked him that, "Why are you booking at 3,000 rupees?" He says, "It's a great property. The place is developed over there. And once it gets completed, it will be sold at 5,000 rupees. And it will happen probably in less than one and a half years. Wife said, "If that is the case, then why don't you book two properties? We have the money. We can shift money from some other low-yielding assets to this. If you are so sure that 3,000 is becoming to 5,000, then your colleagues have booked one property. Why don't you go and book two properties?" And the friend took that decision, booking two properties. And in the end, ended up making far more money than all his colleagues because he bought two properties, whereas his colleagues had bought one. This kind of out-of-box thinking can be done by women. They have ability to process multiple informations at the same time. In my own case, if I see my wife, she is handling calls from neighbors with compassion. She is working together with supply chain management to ensure that kits and ration reaches to the needy people. They deal with government officers to direct them towards needy people and vice versa. She manages my schedule, she manages home, she manages my mother, she manages my daughters in India as well as abroad. At the same time, in her brain, probably 20 things are going, and it all gets processed so smoothly and so nicely. In financial market, to become good investor, you need to process multiple information.
Right.
So women have a genetic advantage in processing multiple information. They just have to take interest in finance, and they will learn finance much faster than men. Fortunately, at Kotak Mutual Fund, we have two great women. Shibani Kurian is head of our equity research, and she has now migrated to being fund manager also. Lakshmi is our CIO fixed income and head of product. She has been managing debt funds over the years with a great track record. And both of them do contribute in giving out-of-box ideas to our mutual fund.
Right. So I think that women empowerment is something that we all need to look at. And, you know, I mean, hats off to everyone, because, you know, at this unprecedented time, we've seen a lot of unsung heroes that have come out that now need that recognition from here on as well, Nilesh. And, you know, I mean, with you as well, you've been associated with a lot of NGOs. And one thing that I've read about you is, Nilesh, that you've always wanted to educate children. Now, if you could just help us understand, what has been the thought process without, you know, with regards to, you know, education of children? Why has that been such an important part of your life?
So one, when I was a kid, my father died at a very young age. And the response then was that, let's forget study and I'll start working, because we had a family to survive. My school principal came and told me that, "No, you have to study. You should not be going into job at this age." And I was in third standard. "Because if you study, you will be able to take your family out. You will be able to survive in the world." My school principal, Jani sir, gave me scholarships, gave me support. And forced me to remain on the study path. There were a lot of temptations to go out and work and earn few rupees. I wanted to do tuitions and he said, no, you should focus on study. Over a period of time, obviously, I started balancing my study and other work. But for whatever reason, what he taught me in third standard that I have to study kept on pushing me to be a professional by studying harder and harder. Wow. And I ended up becoming chartered accountant. And whatever I am today, I am in today upper middle class to rich family. That's only because I studied so hard. So study can lift a person from poverty permanently. Hmm. Now, today, unfortunately, many kids don't get proper study. Or if they get study, it's not practical in real life. So I decided that if I can work with kids in educating them, that will be a fantastic opportunity. There will be many more Nilesh Shahs who will be able to come out of poverty. Fortunately, I had a friend who introduced me to a trust called Parivar. It's run by Vinayak Lohane in West Bengal and Madhya Pradesh. They pick up kids from lower strata of society and help them study and become part of mainline economy, mainline world by providing quality education.
Mm-hmm.
Sitting on that NGO's advisory board in whatever format I can contribute for spreading education among kids is a fantastic experience. Clearly outside of investment world, there are lots of issues to handle. And if all of us contribute in our individual capacity in helping, bringing donors to the needs in providing path where education can empower students, where people from lower strata can become part of mainline economy, I think that will go a long way in improving conditions for them and also our society.
Right. That's a very well thought of a plan as well. And the consideration that you have on this front. And when you said, probably you would love to see a lot of Nileshas, growing up like this. Now, one sector of the society is with regards to the retail investors or the investors who are actually looking up to you right now, Nilesh. Now, for them, do you think this is a good time to invest in markets? Because a lot of them have kept their powder dry right now. Everyone is looking at, okay, there is uncertainty, whether the markets have bottomed, whether the markets have not bottomed. What's the sense? Is it a good time to invest in equity markets? And if someone has 100 rupees right now, how would you advise the investor to break it up in terms of time span?
So one, there's no way one can find out what is the top of the market, what is the bottom of the market. Many people who come today and talk about they were able to exit at 42,000 Sensex, they were able to buy at 32,000 Sensex, well, either they are God or they are lying. I still remember that Warren Buffett's quote, which says that there's no one who can predict future, there's no one who can predict what's going to happen tomorrow, is mostly relevant. This is the time to invest, provided your asset allocation warrants it. Our 10-year, today it's difficult to value market on a P/E ratio basis because earnings are not visible.
Correct.
We have to value it on price to book or market cap to GDP ratio. On a market cap to GDP ratio, our 10-year historical average is about 76%.
Mm.
And we are right now trading at about 60-62%. There is discount to historical average. However, we are not at the bottom. The bottom market cap to GDP ratio was about 43%. So this is time to invest because we are available at a discount to historical valuations. At the same time, this is not the time to invest lump sum because we are trading at a much higher premium to bottom market cap to GDP ratio.
Mm-hmm.
My recommendation will be One, try to invest on a systematic transfer plan basis or multiple tranches, multiple installments, as markets are likely to be fluctuating. When there are good news on fiscal stimulus, monetary stimulus, medical breakthrough, markets will be positive. In absence of those news, markets will be negative.
Correct.
By investing in multiple tranches, we will be able to average ourselves into the market.
Mm-hmm.
The bottom of the market will be determined based on medical solution and interplay of fiscal and monetary stimulus. Second, it's also important to pick up right companies. In a financial sector, one could be HDFC Bank, other could be Yes Bank. You want to be with right management. Third, you want to stay away from leverage company in today's environment where leverage can be lethal. So if you are looking to invest, try to invest in moderately leveraged company. For example, if you have two hotel companies, Hotel A with 30% equity, 70% debt, and Hotel B with 100% equity. In first case, equity will be written off in 3 to 6 months of losses. The asset value of hotel will go to satisfied lenders. In second case, equity will drop by 50, 60, 70%. But eventually it will recover back as hotels around them will be closed. And this will be the hotel which will continue operation. And when things normalize, they will be able to make super profit. So try to stay invested with non-leveraged company. It will be extremely critical that your company should survive the downturn so that you can make money on them at a later date when the upturn comes.
Right. So taking these points into consideration, Nilesh, we have been talking of, you know, I mean, what should how an investor should be looking at the markets. But to do that as well, the stimulus packages that have been announced by the government to help different sectors of the society, with different sectors of business, yes, I'm sure everyone will not get a pie of the pudding. That is going to be difficult. What is your assessment of the stimulus package and its impact on the economy? Because now, majority of the rating agencies are looking at a negative GDP from here on, if you have to look at FY21. And with regards to recovery, either people are saying it could be a V-shaped recovery, it could be a U-shaped recovery. And now I've started to understand that there is a possibility that the recovery could be even a W-shaped recovery, where we could see bouts of, you know, downtick and then uptick by the time that stability emerges. So what's your assessment of the stimulus package on the economy? And what is the kind of recovery that you're expecting?
So one, we are living in a world where for Western world, higher the debt equals higher rating. In Eastern world, lower the debt equals higher rating. So there is class apartheid in rating, where developed countries will be treated in a different manner and developing countries will be treated in a different manner. We have to keep in mind this class apartheid. Hence, we have to be prudent in our approach. Now, if we had given fiscal stimulus in lockdown phase when supply is restricted, what will that create? It will create higher inflation because consumers have money, but there is limited supply. Automatically, prices will go up. So we have to use fiscal stimulus when supply side is unlocked.
Okay.
Second, we are the only country in the world which has ability to fire 4 bullets to contain damage of coronavirus. Fiscal stimulus, monetary stimulus, monetization of dead assets, and out-of-box thinking. Monetization of dead assets and foreign direct investments or trade deficit. Let's first look at foreign trade deficit. As Indians, we have almost $60 billion trade deficit with China. There are many things which we have to import from China, but there are many things which we can make in India. Sonam Wangchuk has now come out with a very popular video talking about boycotting Chinese goods because of the incursion in Ladakh. I just hope and pray that we go back to Swadeshi, we go back to Mahatma Gandhi's thinking of Be Indian, Buy Indian, and substantially slash this trade deficit with China. Assuming that Indians now will recognize Gandhi Bapu and Sonam Wangchuk, we could look to save $20 billion out of that $60 billion trade deficit. This is by replacing your electric lights with made in India goods, you will be able to save $20 billion. That's straightway contributing to containing damage out of coronavirus. The second thing is foreign direct investment. Our domestic savings at 30% is able to create 5, 6, 7% GDP growth. If I want to grow at 8, 9, 10, 11%, I need to augment it with foreign capital. Today, we have created great image for India in the Western world. Two of the oldest civilizations of the world, one China, second India. One gave Wuhan virus to the world, other is giving hydroxychloroquine tablet to the world. Ek dard diya, dusre ne dawai di, ek ne jakham diya, dusra marham laga raha. Bachane wale ki kimat, jaan lene wale se hamesha jyada rahega. So we have to convert this goodwill into foreign capital flows. Samsung came to India long before it went to Vietnam. They make in India and sell in India. Their turnover in India is about $12 billion. In Vietnam, they make in Vietnam and sell all over the world. Their turnover in Vietnam is $62 billion. In an economy which is 1/10 the size of economy, they are 5 times bigger than India. They contribute 28% of GDP to Vietnam. Now, can we help Samsungs of the world to come out of China to India and also help them flourish like Vietnam? That's how you create growth. That's how you contain damage from coronavirus. The government has done excellent things on ease of doing investment. But in India, we have two models. One is Singur model, other is Sanand model. Tata Motors was trying to establish their factory in Singur for years, didn't succeed. Finally, they moved out, came to Sanand, got a red carpet. Land was given, power connection was given, infrastructure was built, approvals were given, 24/7 helpline was there. In 18 months, cars started rolling out of Tata Nano factory. If whole of India follows Sanand model, we will be able to contain damage of coronavirus to a great extent. If whole of India decides to follow Singur model, there is no hope for containing damage of coronavirus. Then comes monetization of dead assets. As Indians, we have imported gold for generations, for centuries. Today, no one knows what's the actual quantity of gold in India, but it could be anywhere between $1.5 trillion to $2 trillion. It could be even higher, but we don't know. Most of this assets are in tijori, in black economy, in unaccounted sources. If we can bring an amnesty scheme to take this gold out of tijori into mainline economy, to that extent, we will have assets, we'll have tax collection to the government, we'll have equity in the balance sheets of citizens, entrepreneurs, and they will be able to leverage it from the banking system. This shift of gold from tijori to mainline economy can result into much higher economic activity through savings and investment and tax collections. Then comes monetary stimulus, where RBI is betting like Rohit Sharma, hitting every ball out of the ground. They have pumped liquidity, they have cut interest rates. But now we have to move to the second stage, where liquidity from banks have to reach to the borrowers. The government announcing MSME credit guarantee scheme, NBFC credit guarantee schemes, will definitely help in moving this liquidity from banks to needy borrowers. We also have to ensure that policy rate cuts by RBI gets reflected into borrowers' account. And finally, there is fiscal stimulus, which we have to do under the watchful eyes of rating agencies. And we have to launch fiscal stimulus when supply side is unlocked so that inflation does not rear its face. This is how we'll have to contain damage of coronavirus. Today, at CII, Prime Minister was talking about coal imports. We are the third largest owner of coal in the world. unfortunately, this coal is below the ground, not above the ground. We import coal worth $20 billion on an average every year. The jobs which should have been created in Jharkhand, Orissa, Bengal, Bihar are being created in Indonesia and Australia.
Correct.
If government and private sector, private miners comes together for extracting coal from the mine, and it doesn't require great technology, we can reduce coal imports by a significant amount. We'll have to import coking coal, but we can reduce thermal coal imports. That $20 billion savings will result into jobs in Jharkhand, Bihar, Orissa, Bengal, and most poorest parts of the country. That's how we'll have to contain damage to the coronavirus by firing bullets of fiscal stimulus, monetary stimulus, monetization of dead assets like gold, and attracting foreign direct investments and reducing trade deficit.
Right. So, Nilesh, with all of this, what are the opportunities across asset classes are you seeing that would come in for a retail investor in this, you know, unprecedented time of COVID?
So one, they have to be overweight equity, but in a calibrated, gradual manner. They could be overweight gold, as normally in low interest rates and high liquidity scenario, gold prices will move up. They can be overweight duration, albeit be ready for volatility. If there are brave souls, they can look at credit risk fund as spreads have widened tremendously. And over last 1 month, when there was no selling by mutual funds or limited selling by mutual fund, spreads have come down.
Mm.
One can also look at offshore assets in select countries or on an emerging market or developed market basis. There could be some opportunity there. So you try to create a portfolio of equity, fixed income, real estate, gold and offshore assets, which will on a portfolio basis deliver you outperformance over inflation and give you real return. Many people in the risk aversion mode in the volatile time goes into bank deposits. But please remember that many a times bank deposits are like holding ice cube in your hand. It will keep on melting without you recognizing. The real return on bank deposits in most of the history has been negative. Your value of money keeps on coming down. So try to invest in a diversified portfolio rather than, you know, safe assets.
Correct.
And they create real negative return.
Right. And Nilesh, if you have to look at equities alone right now, you already spoke about go local, buy local. If we actually look at Swadeshi, if India could supplement China as well as the manufacturing hub for the world, what are the sectors that emerge as opportunities in current times? Because everyone was earlier negative auto, but now thinking that people will move to private vehicles. Yes, probably there will be a demand increase that could come in. It could come in automobiles. There are some negative views coming for financials as well. But what is your holistic picture on the equity side? What sectors are you overweight?
So one, you should be looking to invest in non-leveraged companies across the portfolios, across the sectors. Second, you should be investing with right management. Even in the best of the car, if the driver is bad, you are not going to reach to your destination.
Correct.
Between leverage and right management, you have to choose also appropriate sector. We believe today chemicals and specialty chemicals, albeit a bit expensive, provides good opportunity. It's a multi-year call. China is withdrawing from chemical market. India is moving into that space. Indian companies are getting multi-million dollar contracts, and it will hopefully one day become multi-billion dollar contracts. The investment phase in chemical industry is increasing at a rapid pace. Every company is looking for expansion to cater to the newer markets. Foreign companies are looking to diversify out of China into India. So chemicals and specialty chemicals provides an opportunity just like IT companies provided during Y2K phase. The second one is contract manufacturing firms. There are many companies, so there are few companies they sell it in India. Now they have opportunity to become part of global supply chain management. In contract manufacturing firms, if you can find Narayan Murthy, Azim Premji, Shiv Nandar, you will have a compounder just like IT industry of 2000 in contract manufacturing firms. The third sector which we are looking at is non-fund-based financial services. Clearly, the savings pool is increasing. And with increase in savings pool, there will be opportunity for non-fund-based financial services company, be it insurance, be it asset management. These companies will continue to do well with expansion in savings pool. Then we are also looking at some of the companies where big is becoming better theme is applicable. Today, either because of leverage or because of capital structure or because of supply chain disruption, smaller companies are finding it difficult to compete and retain market share. The big is becoming bigger and better. So if you can pick up leaders in this sector who are benefiting out of this current volatility, they will be in a position to give you great return. And this is true across all the sectors. Try to be with leaders. We are also bullish on cement, especially because one, there is good demand in semi-urban and rural India. There the impact of COVID-19 is not that visible.
Right.
Second, government will be spending money on infrastructure. Road construction has begun. So cement demand should continue to remain robust. And all these sectors with the message of avoiding leverage and avoiding bad management is something which can create a portfolio for you to outperform the market.
Right. And Nilesh, your view coming in, especially if you have to look at automobiles as well as the consumer side of business, because FMCG right now as well, though valuations have come down, we can't look at PE as you already mentioned, but do you think this is still a time to look at FMCG from the discretionary side or from the consumer durable side?
So within FMCG, we are looking at one valuation because there's no point in paying very high valuations for certain companies. Second, we are also looking at value for money brand as we believe Uber luxury brands will find some contraction in sales, whereas value for money brand will be able to survive the downturn. Third thing which we are looking at in consumer space is which companies are able to convert their shampoo to sachets. I think we are going to see sachets model of products and services across industry, not only in FMCG. But in FMCG, as consumption power has come down, it will be important for companies to provide value for money brands in sachets form so that a consumer can continue to remain with your brand. So we are looking at valuation, value for money brand, and ability to miniaturize your offering. That three are the driver for us in FMCG space.
Right. In fact, Nilesh, we have a couple of questions that are pouring in as well from all the viewers that have joined in. The first question coming in from Rohit Somani was saying, dear Nilesh Bhai, first of all, thanks for writing the book, A Direct Take. It's a wealth of knowledge and I think one of the most valuable investments I have made. It is always a pleasure listening to you. What do mutual funds invest, why do mutual funds invest in that companies like HFCL? That's an example that they are giving. You always advocate investing in market leaders and sound companies with good fundamentals. So why are mutual funds investing in weaklings and especially in companies with dubious promoter backgrounds?
So again, it's a learning. When I started my career in 91 as an individual investor, I was swayed like any other by Harshad Mehta boom. I lost all my money. Now that was a learning to not sway by operators. Then came 2000, by which I had become professional fund manager. I made the mistake of investing in technology boom, looking at the valuation. We stayed away from many of the Ketan Parekh companies, what was popularly known then as K10. And I still remember, and this credit goes to my friend, we were debating to invest into HFCL. And he said, just go and open the website of the company. And when I looked at it, there was no website. And he said, will you invest in a company which doesn't even have a website? So clearly, this whole grinding of doing fundamental research pushed us to invest based on research, based on on-ground feedback. 2000, we made error more on the valuation side by following global Fed. Fortunately, we avoided some of the mistakes at Templeton. in investing in K10 companies. 2008 was another learning where we went wrong on the valuation side. We were carried away by infrastructure boom. And I still remember in ICICI Prudential, we were running India's largest infrastructure fund. There were many salespeople who were talking us that we should be launching a scheme and we will collect a close-ended infrastructure fund, a lot of money. From September 2007 till May 2008, we didn't launch a single equity scheme. My CEO, Nimesha, backed me saying that, no, we will not raise any money because our investment team is uncomfortable. Mm. We could have raised a lot of money in equity at that point of time, but we took a decision not to raise any money at that point of time. And if my memory serves me correctly, between September 07 to May 2008, we didn't raise any money. In May 2008, we had launched Focused Fund. It collected some money, promptly crashed in October 2008. But today it is one of the best performing fund. People who invested in May 2008 are still making handsome money on that portfolio. So we are not God. We are all students of the market. We take decisions based on data available. We learn from our mistakes. Our whole objective is not to repeat the mistakes going forward. But you know, the promoters are many a times one step ahead of us. Today, if you look at most of the mutual fund portfolio, company where fundamentals are amiss.
Right. Another question Nilesh is that with the recent downgrades on the Indian government bonds, what would be the impact with regards to bond funds? And if other rating agencies also actually follow suit and downgrade the sovereign bonds, will the equity markets also get impacted according to you?
So the Moody's downgrade of India's rating was on expected lines. It was well discounted by the market. Of course, there will be noise around it, so it could have temporary effect. But is it going to significantly impact borrowing cost of Indian companies abroad? Answer is no. Is it going to influence yields in India? Answer is no. Market and investors do understand that at $490 billion of reserves, India is in far better position to honor its commitment. Markets and investors do know that India has a 5,000-year track record from Harappa Mohenjo-daro days when recorded history of India began till today of not defaulting to any foreigner. If at all, foreigners have come and looted us, but we have never ever defaulted to any foreigner. So investors are going to take a call based on our fundamentals, not based on rating. Rating agencies do create temporary volatility in market, but over a period of time, people recognize fundamentals. In fact, there was a WhatsApp message being circulated when Moody's downgraded Bharti to junk. The stock price was 300. And today we all know where the stock price is. In fact, there was one research also, I'm not able to lay who had published that research, but I'm quoting from my memory, so I could be wrong, but that research did indicate that once rating agency has downgraded a particular country, their stock market has delivered the best return after that.
Right. That's a good one, I think. Nilesh, your last question that I'll take with you from the viewers is in terms of gold. I'm clubbing two questions. How about doing SIP gold ETFs for conservative asset buildup by senior citizen investors? That's one. And the second is, do you think this is a good time to invest in gold as well? Because the kind of up move that we've seen in terms of gold in the last 2 months has been, it's a mind-boggling rally that we've seen. So is this a good time to invest in gold? And what's the kind of outlook do you have in gold if you have to look at another 12 to 18 months perspective?
So don't invest in gold on a 12 to 18 month basis. It's a commodity. You should be looking a longer call. Don't invest in gold because it delivered great return in last 3 months or last 1 year. That's not the reason to invest. You are investing in gold because you believe in environment where interest rates are low and liquidity is high, gold prices tend to do well. It did well between November 2008 to September 2011, where it moved from $750 to about $1,875. Gold can do well if China decides to move part of its FX reserves from hard currencies to gold. And normally China, when they want to buy, they first sell. and then they want to sell their first buy to influence prices. So we'll have to be careful about the volatility in gold prices which China can create if they want to really acquire larger quantity. Gold prices should move well ahead despite recent rally based on lower interest rates and higher liquidity and potential intervention of China. The way to invest in gold is physical gold, gold ETF or gold bonds. If you are looking for 5 to 7 year horizon, do go for gold bonds. They give you coupon income plus gold price appreciation. If you are buying physical gold, be sure of quality and be also sure about the premium you are paying. Many people end up buying 1 gram, 2 gram gold coins or gold physical gold, and they end up paying 15% to 30% premium on that. Compared to physical gold in smaller quantity, gold ETFs are better. The impact cost is much lower and there is daily liquidity and you don't have to worry about quality of gold. Quality is guaranteed over there. So between physical gold, gold ETF and gold bonds, choose what is suitable to you.
Right. That's a good advice coming in on gold. And Nilesh, that's a beautiful choir behind you as well, which is singing along, which is giving us the music as well. But my last question to you is, what would your message be to everyone with regards to coronavirus, how to deal with it in your style? I mean, not an academic answer, the way you would put it forth. And secondly, being an avid reader, your best recommendation for all of us.
So one, there is a WhatsApp message which is being circulated that in 1918 Spanish flu, more people died in second wave rather than the first wave. As when relaxation came, people thought that the flu virus was behind them. Mm. In fact, it was very much present and it struck back with far more vigor than the first wave. We have to learn what happened 100 years before and behave very, very responsibly. One person making a mistake will cause entire society. So, relaxation is coming from the government, not from the virus. Our doctors are already bursting at seam. They are doing a tremendous job and we must not increase their workload. It is time to follow all the guidelines and ensure that we remain safe. We don't overburden our medical fraternity. Correct. And we fight this virus and defeat it rather than create a second wave, which will be worse than the first wave. In terms of reading, I mean, read everything possible. When I was a kid, I had read Ramayana and Mahabharata without recognizing what is the value of that. To me, at that point of time, it was entertainment. Over the years, I have found that even in the field of investment, many of those anecdotes come handy. And one of my favorite anecdotes is from Mahabharata, where Lord Krishna goes to meet Duryodhan before the beginning of the war and requests Duryodhan to settle with Pandavas, give them the legitimate share. Eventually offers that you just give 5 villages and Duryodhan refuses. After all the talks of dharma, adharma, duty, righteousness, Duryodhan replies, Janami dharmam. Nachme pravrutti, janami adharmam, nachme nivrutti. Oh great Krishna, please don't tell me what is right. I exactly know what is right, what is dharma, but I can't follow it. That's my nature. And don't also tell me what is wrong. I exactly know what I'm doing is wrong, but I can't resist it. This is what is applicable in the investment world also. All of us know that one has to be a long-term investor. One has to be a regular investor. One should not panic when markets correct. Ups and downs of a market is as certain as ups and downs of a roller coaster. We all know asset allocation is important. We all know that timing the market is impossible. We all know that no one can predict future. Yet, we end up following tips. Yet, we try to time the market. Yet, we panic when correction sets in. We all have to control our Duryodhan, which does not allow to do what is right thing, but forces us to the path of doing wrong things. This is Kaliyug, So Krishna Bhagwan is not going to be available to you, but his learnings in Gita, in Mahabharata is available to you. Learn those things and apply in your real life investment world. Even a book, a granth like Mahabharata can teach you so many things for material things like investment. So just read whatever is available. Read whatever you can lay your hand on. Every day spend minimum 1 to 2 hours for reading. And I'm sure that's going to come handy to you. And that's going to come helpful to you over a period of time.
That's a brilliant advice that you've given as well, Nilesh, and brilliant anecdotes that we keep hearing from you, which actually help us relate with the work that we're doing individually as well. And that's something which I've always appreciated, that I've always followed in my career, at least with you, with regards to your anecdotes. And that's when I developed my reading skills as well. But thank you so much for joining us on the show at Nirmal Bhai. I hope you enjoyed the conversation as well. And a lot of things that we've taken back from you today, a lot of things that the investors and all the ones who've attended the webinar have taken from you today as well. We from at Nirmal Bhai wish you to stay home, stay safe. And, you know, I mean, all of us, stay home, stay safe from here on.
Stay safe, stay invested.
Thank you, Nilesh.
Thank you. Thank you.